Okay, I'll do a little video here on my new-to-me rifle, I guess. And probably most people that watch the channel probably know what this thing is already. They're probably like thinking, like, what the fuck is he doing? Why is he buying more of them? Because I have the whole set, guys. They're like fucking Pokemon. You gotta collect the fuck out of these. But so I got the 401. This is the 35 self-loading, and this is a 1905 model. And it's sort of... That's just quite a lot of reflection after buying the 401. This one probably kind of fits the bill better for kind of like just wandering around the woods and doing planking and stupid stuff. 401's good for, you know, big game hunting is sort of what it was designed for. This one here is considerably weaker cartridge. And it's easier to make brass for. It's easier to make bullets for. You don't have to like buy a special mold normally. I probably end up breaking down and getting one or something anyway. I don't know. But it's... And if we're just plinking around the woods, this is fine. Like, it's perfect. It's a lighter gun. It's a little... Hopefully I can work really weak-ass loads into it. Hopefully, because the spring and stuff is a whole lot weaker than this one, obviously. I'm like the 401. It's older. It's cooler. It's more rare. It's weirder. Those are all pluses in my book, anyway. So yeah, so this is the 1905 Winchester self-loading rifle. It's in 35 self-loading. There's the cartridge here. Basically, it's a 38 special with a... The rim's a little bit different, and it has this weird bevel, so the rounds don't get stuck on each other. Shot 180 grain soft point bullet around 1450 at the most. It's probably around 1400, I guess. It was described as kind of like a 3840 black powder ballistics, but it was semi-automatic, so it's... It was sort of considered a deer cartridge way back in 1905, but within short time, most people decided, nah, it's not that great. So, but a lot of people shot a lot of deer with 38-40 out of rifles, and most of those, the ballistics were pretty pathetic, too, so, and they weren't semi-automatic, so, but we'll just go over some of the difference between this and the later ones. I'll make this video terribly long. If you want to videos on a little bit more detail about certain things about it, then yeah, I can do that, or when I get into reloading, I can make a video on that, or whatever, but, it's kind of neat to see the differences and things they changed between the older one. That's basically the first centerfire one. They had the 1903 that was in that 22 Winchester automatic, which unfortunately you can't shoot 22 long rifle in it, so, but this one is, the first centerfire one. This one's actually made in 1905. So, this is the plain model. There was a fancy model as well that had, like I said, checkering and stuff here and up on there. Mechanically, they're basically identical. They just sort of scaled them up as they went. But there's a few differences. I can see why they changed certain things. These had straight stocks. I don't know if they had pistol grips on these ones or not in their production run or not, but they had straight stocks for the 1907, 1910. I have a pistol grip kind of jobby. The way the action comes down is more or less the same. You push this little button here and you unscrew that, and you can pull the butt and the trigger guard kind of deal off of it. The extractor is a bit different from what I can see. Magazines are basically the same. Your safety is the same. Mag comes out the same. One sort of difference you'll notice is the way the wood goes here. It actually goes up into here, where the other ones, the metal comes to here. So it's sort of one big difference. They're all like fairly fragile handguards. It's sort of common of all the models. Maybe not the 22. It might have been a little bit better. But it's a plastic butt plate. I think some had steel. The 1907s, I think. The next big difference that I can notice is the way the nose cap goes on. 1907, 1910 have a threaded nut that goes on and holds the nose cap on. That little part that's staked into the barrel, on the 1910 anyway, staked into the barrel, and the nose cap butts up against it, and then the threaded nut goes on, has a little, like a ball bearing kind of detent kind of deal. On it, that it sort of, you know, ratchets on. This one just has a screw going through, and there's a little cutout in the barrel that the screw goes through, and that holds the nose cap from going wherever. It has the This is basically the same operation handle. Sights are more or less just standard. This one, I don't know what it's off of. It's not the original anyway. It's got a 22-inch barrel, which is, I think, the 351 and the 401, they're both 20-inch barrels, I believe. I don't think you get a longer one, but these are 22 inches, which, I don't know, I guess that makes the 35, gives it the advantage. It's way more powerful than the 351, I hear. Yeah, right. But, those are, the next big thing I noticed was the way the buffer is inside. You got your front part of your breech block comes down in here, your weight. You got your rod to go through with the spring on it, and your buffer is here that the weight comes back and slams into. And on the there's a pedestal that's part of the bottom of the barrel that the buffer sits on. On my 401, it has a circular piece of steel with a base on it, and the buffer is down in that. And then there's a buffer washer that is has a smaller part and then it's bigger, and then it sits down inside of this sort of can-shaped thing that the buffer is in. This one, there's a round washer, buffer, which is two pieces, or two sort of this fibrous jobby. I should, if anyone wants to actually look at it, I can take the wood off, I suppose, and do another video, but anyway, there's washer, two fiber buffers, and then there's another steel washer, and it's not enclosed. Like, you take the wood off, you can see the buffers from the side. And I can kind of see why they changed that, because this one actually has a chip out of the bottom of the buffer. Like, when this weight comes back and smashes it, there's no support of the outside of the buffer, so if it gets hit and parts chip off, then they can fall off. And this buffer has probably been in there since 1905, so it's 111 years old, but it does look pretty decent. It still, it does seem to be doing its thing. Like, it seems like it's whacking in the buffer, not just steel. But it's kind of different how you can see how they change that. Because there's a little bit different between 1907 and 1910, I think, too, the way the buffer is set up. I forget how the thing that the buffer set on was a little different or whatever, but anyway, it's just kind of, you can see how they updated it, and the weight inside is quite square, so that makes the wood kind of square. It's more square inside, and it kind of makes it more fragile, because this part here is it's like there's a square edge right here and then down there, and it sort of makes this a bit more fragile, or it seems like it would, where they rounded it. Like with the 1910, it's the size of the weight are more rounded off, so the wood is more sort of rounded inside, so it kind of makes it stronger. I think when you have like weird sharp angles in wood, it just makes, just asks for it to like kind of break. But it's this one's, it's got a few cracks in it, but it's fared fairly well for all these years. But I put a little bit of glue in these, some little hairline cracks that were starting or whatever, but not a big deal. But I plan on using the gun, but I don't plan on, like, I'll baby it a bit, but I'm not going to be a safe queen, I hope not. Another thing I noticed, there's not a difference between this gun, but the mag is really good shape. Like, the bluing on it is kind of weird. It's like almost like this mag is new to it or something. Get in there. But it's the funny, the wear marks on the receiver are almost like somebody was carrying it without the mag in it. Like, they were hunting with no mag, like they were just shooting one round or something. But, so maybe I'll do a little bit more in-depth video on reloading for it, if anybody's interested in some of the internals. I'll probably take it apart eventually and clean inside here. But, so, anyway, thanks for watching, guys, and we'll talk to you later.